is a bit of a family heirloom. It's a Jaguar XK120 fixed head coupe made by Dinky Toys in the 60s. My granddad bought it for my dad, and it was the first toy car I ever played with as a kid. But today, I'm being given the keys to the real thing. Somehow, I'm being allowed to drive a 1953 Jaguar XK120. The XK120, you could say, was the Bugatti Veyron of the 1950s. So what is it like to drive, and how does its technology hold up in 2019?
Well, before I get started, I grabbed James May to give me some tips. How should a naive, spoon-fed millennial like myself approach driving a classic car?
My tips for driving very old cars, if you're a very young person, would be leave plenty of time for braking, because they take a long time to stop. Now, in the olden days, everything took a long time to stop, so it didn't matter, but now everything else will stop very quickly. That's the first one. Double declutter as much as possible, especially going down through the box and especially going into first, because there often won't be any synchromesh at all there. And don't slam the throttle, because these things will be on carburetors and you will probably flood them. Anyway, maybe you have some other tips. You can add them in the comments down there. And whilst you're down there, why not like or subscribe?
So, tackling James's first point there, the gearbox. On a modern car, a gearbox has something called synchronizers or synchros. And that basically means that you can put the clutch down, pull a gear across, and select the next gear without any trouble. Basically, it's a really nice helping hand to match the input of the gearbox to the output, meaning you get a nice smooth shift, no crunching. Back in the 1950s, however, you could not take that for granted at all. Either your car had no synchro meshes, or it had no synchro mesh in first and very rudimentary synchro meshes in the rest of the gearbox. So you basically have to just do everything much slower. The XK120 has synchros in gears 2, 3, and 4, but they're pretty rudimentary. So let's try both ways of changing gear. First, double clutch, second to third. Clutch into neutral, clutch into third gear. And then again, third to fourth, clutch into neutral, clutch into fourth gear. So you just have to be patient, nice and slow with the gearbox, and it allows the gears to match up their speeds and you get no crunching. Now, let's try the other method of changing gear, just being patient. Jay Leno calls it the shift 1-2 shift method. So instead of double clutching, you just single clutch, but you're just nice and slow across the gate. So let's try it. Nice and slow into third. And then again, third to fourth, no double declutching, just being nice and smooth. There you go. You can't rush a car like this. It needs to be massaged into changing gear. So to think that guys raced these back in the day, how the hell they managed to shift gears as quickly as possible, I will never have the skill for it, definitely.
It's safe to say that driving this car smoothly took some patience, along with the odd mistake. If you change gears slightly too quickly in this car, this happens.
No. Very tricky thing with this car, and in a lot of classics, is the gate of the gearbox is really tight, so you get so close to selecting reverse when you really want first. First in this car is just straightforward like that, but it's right next to reverse, a matter of millimeters, but you can feel it. You can feel it going into reverse. There's a clunk. So what made this Jag so fast? Well, there's two main things. One was its engine, and two, its aerodynamic design. When you look at the car, you can just see it's going to cut through the air as seamlessly as possible, which means it can hit a high top speed. Also, the engine within it is the Jaguar XK Straight 6, an all-time great of British engineering. At the time, it was pretty revolutionary with its twin cam and aluminium head. That meant it could rev high and create horsepower, but efficiently. So those two things combined meant this car achieved a top speed of 124.6 miles per hour. That was at a time when most cars were struggling to reach 100. With some slight modifications, it achieved 132 miles an hour, and then with some serious modifications, it went on to 172 miles an hour in the early 1950s. That was absolutely incredible at the time.
The XK120 was knocked off the top spot by the Italians and the Germans, most notably through the Mercedes 300 SL, an equally pretty car to have snapped the record. The most special thing about this car is that it has never been restored. The whole car is 100% original, meaning that it is wonderfully patinated. Tiny little dinks in the paintwork, small rings of rust around the lights, a scuff on the door card where all the past owners have brushed their shoes, and beautifully worn leather seats that have all the creases and crinkles of thousands of happy miles. Like my toy, it has been properly used, played with, battered and bruised, but enjoyed. Just the way Jaguar intended.
Next thing about a classic car is the brakes. Now, in a modern car, you have nice, powerful disc brakes, where you have a nice big brake disc that has pads that grip against it to create some decent stopping force. As you can hear, we don't have them. We have drum brakes, which instead of clamping onto a disc, they push out. There are brake shoes that push out onto the brake drum to produce a braking force. It's not the most efficient way to brake, but that was the technology back in the 50s. So driving it in 2019, you just have to leave yourself more space. Your braking distance is going to increase dramatically compared to driving a normal car, and you just have to get used to that. One thing I've learned about driving a classic like this today is you have to learn the car. It has all these little foibles that you just have to get used to if you're going to drive it smoothly, like the brake pedal in this car. When I first went to brake, you just expect a nice firm pedal to put your foot against, but this one shuggles from side to side. So as you press onto the brake, you have to manage that sideways movement of the brake pedal along with the drum brakes, which aren't that fantastic. But I mean, once you get used to it, I guess it just becomes normal, but you don't get that in a modern car. Now the next thing is power steering. You do not have it in the Jaguar XK120 from the 1950s. All you've got is you, rack and pinion, and your upper body strength. And that makes it a really physical drive. I don't know if you can tell if I'm sweating in this tiny cockpit, wrestling with the steering wheel, but especially at slow speeds, as you're about to find out, it's a bit of an arm wrestle. This big wheel, get in. Get on the power, there she goes. It's satisfying when you get a turn in nice and precise, but it's tough. I am perspiring right now. Another thing you need to watch out for in this car is it's got a very simplistic ladder chassis and a rudimentary differential at the back, which means that it's not great at driving in a straight line. In a modern car, you can just be on and off the throttle and the car's going to stay fairly straight and true. In this car, however, if you're on and off the throttle, the differential has to work out where the power is going, and the characteristics of a ladder chassis mean that it wanders across the road quite dramatically. So you have to constantly make adjustments to the car to make sure you're driving straight. Now, a great thing with the XK straight six engine is it has loads of torque throughout the rev range. So I'm in third gear now and it will do absolutely everything. It will do slow corners, it will get you up to motorway speed. It's a really, really versatile engine, and that's why it lasted so long into Jaguar's history. Over 40 years, absolutely phenomenal. And it's such a smooth engine. Straight sixes are the best. One of the coolest things about a classic car is the startup. It is like bringing a living thing to life. It is really cool. So in this car, you just turn the ignition, pretty quiet, and then it's a push start. But you have to give it a bit of throttle just to open up the engine, get more air in, and get it turning over. Is he going to stay awake? See, not an easy startup. You have to really massage the car into starting, but satisfying nonetheless. Right, let's get going. Brake off, quirky little indicator on.
The main thing I took from this drive was that you cannot underestimate how much impact a toy car can have on a kid growing up. It could have been any car that I first set my hands on as a 3-year-old, but it just so happened to be an XK120, a legend of its time, and still a legend today.